We'll be moving into our public hearing section. This will be on water and wastewater rate study. The item will be presented by Diana Langley, our Public Works Director. Diana.
Good evening, Mayor, Council. So tonight I'm going to give an overview of the two previous workshops that we held, the first in January, the second in February. So I've combined slides from both workshops just to provide a summary to the public. So when we're talking about revenue requirements, the revenue requirements are based upon capital investment, debt service, and operating costs. Capital investment is ongoing capital projects, which are pay-as-you-go, and debt service projects are past capital investments that are financed over time. The sources of fund for water include capital revenues and operating revenues. Operating revenues are water sales, backflow prevention fees, interest on investments. Capital revenues include extension fees, connection fees, the Hillcrest water surcharge, and interest on investments. For wastewater, very similar, although you can see the capital revenues are much smaller. The operating revenues are the wastewater service charges, septage fees, lab fees, pretreatment permits, interest on investments. And the capital revenues are extension fees, connection fees, and interest on investments. When looking at the water sales over the last few years, the water sales make up a large portion of the water revenue. Revenues were down 3.12% for fiscal year 13-14, 12.14% for fiscal year 14-15, and 19.32% for the first 6 months of fiscal year 15-16. And what this graph shows is the blue is our operating and maintenance expenses, red is debt service, green and yellow are projects. The black line represents our revenue under existing rates, and the dotted blue line represents anticipated revenues under the approved 2011 rates. So when we did the 2011 rate study, of course we weren't anticipating the drought, and the drought has had a significant impact on the water revenues. When we look at the wastewater revenues, this graph is very similar. So blue is O&M expenses, red debt service, green and yellow the projects. The black represents the revenue under existing rates, and the dashed blue line represents the anticipated revenues under the 2011 approved rates. And the reason that the wastewater fund hasn't had the same decline as the water fund is because residential customers are charged a flat rate for wastewater. And so you're really seeing a drop due to mainly the commercial customers because they pay based upon their actual water usage. When you look at operational needs, they're comprised of three areas: operating costs, debt service, and capital investment. Operating costs are comprised of fixed costs that do not vary by the volume treated, and then variable costs, which of course vary depending upon the volume treated. You can see that the split is very similar between water and wastewater. When looking at operating costs for water, going back to fiscal year 10-11, the fiscal year 15-6 number is based on budget, whereas prior years are actual. So in 14-15, the savings of actual versus budgeted was $466,000. This is mainly due to savings in salaries and benefits, a little bit in operation and maintenance, and then also savings in chemicals. Again, in wastewater, the fiscal year 15-16 is budgeted, and the other years are actual. In fiscal year 14-15, the savings of actual versus budgeted was $1.3 million. This savings is primarily due to $500,000 for salaries and benefits due to vacancies, $300,000 for heat and power, $200,000 for operation and maintenance, and $100,000 for professional services, $50,000 for chemicals. The other element is debt service. For water, we have currently three basic loans. The total of those loans is $46 million with an approximate annual payment of $2.92 million. You can see that the final debt payment is due in 2032 and 2035. When looking at the debt coverage ratio, you can see that we're estimating in fiscal year 16-17 that we're going to drop below the 1.20 that we're required to have per our bond covenant. And so what happens is if we drop below the 1.20, our bond covenants state that we will move forward with a rate increase to therefore increase our revenues to then meet that 1.2 threshold. For wastewater, we currently have 5 loans. Those total a little over $30 million. And the approximate annual payment is $2 million. The final debt payment ranges from 2025 to 2035. Again, when looking at the debt service coverage ratio for wastewater, you can see in 16-17, we're starting to get close to that 1.20 threshold. The other element is capital investment. This is just a graph showing our capital investment over the last few years. In water, that 910 is basically related to some ERA projects that we completed, also the surface water conversion project. Since then, we've had some grant-related projects such as the fish screen and then the low-lift pump station security improvements. For wastewater, the big expense in fiscal year 13-14 was related to the downtown sewer collection project, and then we also had the oxygen reactors and 12 kV projects at the plants, and those also had grant funding included in those projects. When we look at system condition, to give a little overview, the water treatment plant was placed into operation in 1969, expanded in 1999 and 2007. The current permitted capacity is 42 million gallons per day, and below is a table that shows our average demands. You can see the impact of the drought and the conservation mandate on our average demands. In 2011, summer demand was 20.7 million gallons per day. In 2015, it was 15 million gallons per day. Here's an aerial photo of our water treatment plant. This is basically just to show the treatment processes involved. I'll follow up later with an aerial photo of our wastewater treatment plant, which you can see is a much more intensive process for treatment. Our water distribution system is comprised of 265 miles of transmission and distribution mains. The sizes range from 3 inches to 36 inches, and we have 6 storage tanks within the distribution system. When we look at needs at the water treatment plant, we've identified some priority projects. The priorities on the right-hand side, so it ranges from 1 to 4. And we have electrical and instrumentation improvements. And I'm gonna have some pictures as a follow-up in just a moment. The aquifer storage recovery dash second well, fluoride system replacement, security improvements, carbon feed system replacement, backwash recovery, sedimentation flock basin rehabilitation, and groundwater well abandonments. Those total about $9.6 million. And so here is a photo of the concrete at the sedimentation flock basin, and then this represents the electrical and instrumentation. You know, I said the plant was constructed in the late 1960s, and we still have original elements of the plant in operation today. With the water distribution system, we've identified priority projects as being recoating water storage reservoirs, replacement of water mains, and replacement of water services and water meters. The replacement of water mains is an estimate, and at no point would we think that we would be able to replace all of the water mains within the city, but this is just an estimate. The city currently experiences approximately 14% water loss on a rolling basis. With the development and implementation of the water loss control plan, it's anticipated that the results will show the need to address leaking water mains and services. Here's a couple of pictures of our water distribution system. The top right is the harder tank. You can see that the paint is starting to peel and chip away, which leads to rust. And so that has to be addressed, but you also have to recoat the interior of the tanks because over time, those need to be recoated as well. And then the other two pictures are just showing where, you know, sometimes you're lucky and the water seeps to the road surface and you can tell that you have a water leak. And at that point in time, when we go to uncover them, this is what they look like. The wastewater treatment plant was placed into operation in 1972 and expanded in 2005. The current permitted capacity is 10.5 million gallons per day, with the current average flow of 6.5 million gallons per day, and the solids coming into the facility total about 11,000 pounds per day. So when you compare processes to the water treatment plant, you can see that this is a much more intensive process to clean the water sufficiently to then discharge it to the Feather River. The wastewater collection system is comprised of 173 miles of sewer mains. Sizes range from 6 inches to 42 inches, and there are 17 sewer lift stations throughout the distribution system. And I think it's important to note that both on the water distribution system and the sewer collection system, we have pipes that are nearing 100 years old. And on water distribution, in the neighborhood that we replaced all of the sewer lines, so that orange olive area, there's 3-inch galvanized water mains that have been in place for almost 100 years. And so at some point, we will be forced to address those, not only to increase fire flows within those neighborhoods, but just to address the leaks within the line and the services. Here are projects associated with the wastewater treatment facility. The priority 1 through 4 projects total $43.55 million. And so to give you an idea, this picture is the inside of the digester lid. So it needs to be replaced. These are the bar screens. So this is where sewage is coming into the headworks of the plant. So it screens and removes a lot of the solid materials. And then this is the belt press that extracts the water from the sludge so that we can then send it to Recology. This is a picture of the instrumentation electrical. Like I said, just like the water treatment plant, we still have a lot of original elements to the wastewater treatment facility. And then here's the chlorine contact basin. You can see here where the aggregate is exposed and needs to be basically recoated. And then finally, the outfall diffuser. So in 2011, we lost the line that went underneath the Feather River to our ponds. And so we had to do an emergency project to replace that line. Well, when the Feather River changed, our outfall diffuser, which we had previously discharged our treated effluent into the river, became exposed. And you have to have a certain amount of coverage over that outfall in order to discharge into the river. And so basically since 2012, we have not been able to discharge into the river, and we're continuing to discharge into our ponds. Well, the state would like us to get out of the ponds. We would like to get out of the ponds because it's increased cost for us to continue to have to monitor those ponds. And so we hired a consultant to do a study, and they looked at the river and went back in time to see what is the most stable area of the river for a new outfall diffuser, and it's located right about here. And there's a couple different ways that you could utilize that area. One, you could utilize the existing pipe that we already have going to the ponds and then build your new outfall, or you could build a new line on the land side of the West Feather River levee and then cut across. So several options to consider. With the wastewater collection system, we have replacement of sewer mains and manholes and lift station improvements. So here are pictures of an old brick manhole within the collection system, and then also a concrete sewer pipe. The sewer gases just eat away at the cement and the concrete to the point that the rock becomes exposed. And as you jet and clean the line, you just continue to pull rock out of the pipe until it gets to the point that it's so thin that it becomes brittle and can collapse or crack. At that point, you can no longer clean the line, and then it's just exacerbating the situation. Existing water rates. So the council approved a rate study in 2011 that went through the latest rate increase was implemented on September 1st, 2015. and 1 HCF is equivalent to 748 gallons. The rate history for a 1-inch water meter. You can see the rate increase was adopted in 2011. Prior to that, there had not been a rate increase in 4 years. The way a water bill is calculated is you take the base rate plus the amount over the base allocation times the flow rate. So for example, if your monthly use is 20 HCF, you would take the base rate of $21.59 and add the 5 HCF times $1.43, which is the volumetric rate, to come up with a total bill amount of $28.74. And the reason that I picked 20 HCF, that was the average annual water use in 13-14. I happened to look today of what the average annual water use was in 2015, and it was about 14.5 units. So you can see that conservation has worked in the last couple of years. The average annual water use has decreased in that 2-year period. So at the second workshop in February, presented 3 rate options for council. A 2-year rate plan that covers operation and maintenance expenses plus debt service, and then 2 options under the 5-year rate plan. Option 1 covers O&M expenses, debt service, and the priority 1 and 2 projects that were covered under the previous slides. And then option 2 covers O&M expenses, debt service, plus all projects with the exclusion of any type of tertiary treatment project. One of staff's recommendations is to reduce the baseline HCF by 1/3. So for instance, for a 1-inch water service where the existing baseline HCF is 15 units, we're proposing to decrease it to 10 units. That is in line with the state's mandate that the city can serve. Our current requirement's 29%, just recently reduced from the previous 32%. So what do those rate options look like? Here's the 2-year rate plan. And the reason that it doesn't go beyond 2 years is because at the end of the 2 years, I would anticipate that we'd be back before council with a recommendation for either one way or another for a rate increase. Since this only covers O&M and debt service, I would anticipate we would be back with additional requests for a rate increase. The 5-year rate plan option 1. And I think it's important to note this current rate is based upon the 15 units, but this is showing the proposed reduction in baseline units. And then the 5-year rate plan option 2. So what do these rate plans do? Under the 2-year rate plan, the rates cover O&M and debt service. Under the 5-year rate plan option 1, it's O&M debt service plus the priority 1 and 2 projects. And then 5-year rate plan option 2, O&M debt service plus all of the priority projects. And then we look at a comparison to other agencies. You can see that Yuba City's rates are in line with the region. There was a great article recently in the Sacramento Bee that showed rates for the Sacramento region. And when looking at that article, our rates seem to be in line with that region as well. So key decision points for water: reduce the base allocation by 33%, and then also the rate plan. So now I'll shift into wastewater. So the existing wastewater rates, as I mentioned previously, residential is based upon a flat rate every month. It's not based upon water usage. The commercial rates pay the base amount, the base charge, plus they pay a flow charge for actual water used. And so the rate history for a single family dwelling, you can see when the rate increase was adopted in 2011. And then the 3 years prior to that, there was no rate increase. Industrial is charged differently, and we don't have a lot of industrial customers, but they are charged based upon their flow charge, the biochemical oxygen demand, and the suspended solids. So very similar to water, for wastewater, we have 3 rate options. the two-year plan, which again covers O&M expenses and debt service, the five-year rate plan option one, which then includes the priority one and two projects, the five-year rate plan option two, which includes all projects but does not include tertiary treatment. And then here's the proposal for the industrial customers and septage haulers. So the two-year rate plan, the five-year rate plan option one, and the five-year rate plan option two. And I just want to note, the at the second workshop, there were a lot of comparison graphs that were provided to council. Those are available on the city's website. The presentation's on the city's website if anybody wants to go and look at the comparison charts. So when you look at a funding allocation over time for the two-year rate plan, again, it covers O&M and debt service. The five-year rate plan option one includes the priority one and two projects, and option two includes the additional projects. So when we look at a comparison to other agencies, this light green is our current. This is the two-year plan, the five-year plan option one, and the five-year plan option two. And I should note that this is for year one. So key decision points for wastewater are the rate plan itself. So just quickly to go over the Proposition 218 process. Council would need to approve the guidelines for the submission and tabulation of protests. We would mail a notice of public hearing for proposed water and wastewater rate increases at least 45 days prior to the protest hearing, hold a protest hearing, and then the rate increase is approved if written protests did not exceed 50% of the property owners or customers. So to wrap up, I would just like to note that we have scheduled an open house for April 2nd. From 9 a.m. to noon at the water treatment plant and the wastewater treatment plant. There will be staff at both, and we will have tours throughout that time period, equipment on display, and have staff available to answer any questions. So next steps, we would come back to council to accept and adopt the rate study, approve the guidelines for the submission and tabulation of protests, set the protest hearing date, and approve notices for the Proposition 218. Hearing. And so the item before you tonight is the public hearing.
Thank you very much, Diana. Any questions from council currently for Diana?
Diana, quick question. You talked about the leaks in the system. Do we know approximately how much or what percentage of water is lost through leaks in the system?
So we have a rolling average of about 14%. You're never going to get to 0%. It doesn't make sense from a cost perspective to try to address all of the leaks. I think that the goal is to get below 10%. And so with the water loss control program, the consultant will actually do that analysis. At what point is it not financially feasible to continue to try to chase leaks? So they'll go through the analysis of prioritizing what should you address and what, from a financial standpoint, is okay, because you're going to spend more than what you're going to gain from it.
Right. And so part of that repair process is the projects that you talked about in the 2 5-year plans.
Yeah. And I should note for on the water side, because Pat Miller sent a question last week about the priority one and two projects on the water side related to the distribution system. So the 5-year rate plan option two includes $1 million to be spread between the meters, the pipelines, and the tanks. And so we would have to determine how that's allocated.
So every percent that we can repair or recapture in leaks, that also helps us with our conservation numbers too.
Yes.
So that again helps us, because we're now capturing revenue also from that percentage that we capture.
Correct.
That is leaking too. So, yes. All right. Thank you.
Go ahead. Good chair. The mayor. My question was, is I just wanted to clarify that the base year where that's being used is the 20 units. Is that correct? Is that what the, in what year is that? Because I know the state, its reduction requirement of 33% was based on a certain year. Is that 2013?
Yes. And so the numbers, we started this rate study in late 2014. So the first full year of data that we had was fiscal year 13-14. And so the model's based upon water consumption from fiscal year 13-14.
And was that the 20 units?
Yes.
Right there? Okay. And then from there, we're supposed to reduce by the 33%, correct?
Mm-hmm. Well, you're mixing a little bit. So the baseline allocation, the 15 units that's currently covered in the bill, that's what we're proposing be reduced by 33% for one-inch water service.
Okay.
And so the 20 units, that's just the average annual water usage that one-inch water customers used in fiscal year 13-14.
Well, with that statement, I know where you're going with it, but we have already reduced by 20% the 2020 goal. If you take from reduction from 2013-14 to what we're going to be doing there, if we reach the 29 or the 33%, that actually, when you do the mathematics, it comes out the 20% reduction by 2020. So we've already reached that. To me, it looks like we've reached that goal, but not the one that the state wants on 33%, the way they calculate their goal.
Right. But it's important to note that that's a number that we need to sustain, the 20% by 2020. And so if the drought were to go away, we would still need to encourage our customers to sustain that 20% reduction by 2020.
Yes.
Any other questions?
Nope, that's it.
All right, we have had two We've had two public workshops on this, and we encourage the public to be involved in this process as we continue to move forward with our rate study and certainly the recommendations. So at this point, we're going to open this as a public hearing. Anyone that would like to speak to this, please move forward toward the podium. And we do have a speaker card. Pat Miller would like to address us.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. I think I'm Pat Miller, President of the Sutter County Taxpayers Association, and we fully recognize that we must maintain and make the necessary repairs to our water and sewer system. I would encourage you to look for as many grants, even though those are taxpayer money too, but it would spread the cost out among more people. And I have concerns about reducing the baseline from the 15 HCFs to the 10 HCFs. That's a 33% increase in our rates right there. And then once you get over that, and you get over the baseline faster, so it's going to increase our costs even more. The folks in this area are not wealthy people, and a lot of them are on fixed incomes. And there was an article in the Appeal Democrat in December that indicated that the average salary for people in this area was, I think, $41,000. That's not a lot, and just do everything you possibly can to keep those costs down. Appreciate that very much.
Thank you very much, Ms. Miller. Other members from the public? Sir, if you just state your name and...
Okay, my name is Dale McDowell. And on the... do we have meters on all residential property in the city?
We have... meters. We have meters on all residential properties, and in fact, on commercial properties
also. Okay. On the rates, incidentally, on the average usage, and you're talking about conserving, and when the average usage was like 20 units, you realize how much water that is?
It's a tremendous amount of water.
Yeah, and so obviously there's been a lot of people that hasn't been conserving if they're still using that that 20,000 gallons. But anyway, I checked a couple of rates here, and for Linda, and we're comparing 10 units, apples to apples. Their charge is $13.50 for 10 units. Olivehurst is $17.35, and the proposal here is $27.64. And we talk about 33%. That's a small percentage. The increase for our water here is like 93%, from $1.43 a unit to $2.76 a unit, comes out to 93%. Over a five-year period, that amount to 195%. So, and cutting down from to 10 units, you're going, basically, you said the average was like 14 units. So basically, you're going to get everybody paying more. It's because they're going to go over the base pay, the base rate. And
you still have time. You're not done yet.
Well, that's about all. Then, so what it means to the city, as far as the increase, right now, just by, there's 436 units in an acre foot of water. So you basically get $623 for an acre foot of water. With this new increase, you would get 92% increase. You go from $623 to $1,201. So, and then the water that came in where you got allocated more water, what was it, 960 acre foot of water? Calculate that out, and that comes out, that's over $1 million there that you're going to have, that you have. The residential properties, they don't have any, carryover, and it's, you know, you're going to have everybody paying over, and the rates are really going to go up. And so these are the percentages that you should look at and consider. I know you need a raise on, you know, the rates, but that's a little outlandish, I think. Okay.
Thank you, Mr. McDowell. If you, anyone would like to follow Elaine Miles, please step towards the back of the room and line up.
Okay, I'm not prepared for this, but Dale really presented something. I only use 2 to 4 units. I have a rock yard. It's ugly as can be. But when you reduce this to 10, and you say everybody has an average of 10, Dale brought up something I know. We own a rental with our daughter in Linda. 6.75 units is what their base rate is. So the most they have to pay is the 6.75 units. But you're making us all along here pay for 15. And now you want to reduce it for 10 and charge us even more than the 15 did. This community, if you read the paper, and I'm a retired government employee, but the government workers make enough money to do this. The people on Social Security, the people in this community that don't have full year-round jobs cannot afford this. This isn't the only one. It's wastewater, it's the ecology, it's all of it. Mandatory things. Several years ago, I proudly said, I paid off my house. A guy said to me, no, you didn't. I said, I own it. No, you don't. The government owns it. Because if you can't pay what they decree you have to pay, you'll lose it. And that's what I'm seeing here. The Hillcrest water issue, why in the world are we shutting down groundwater wells when we can't even reach the river water with our water in Yuba City now? It's caused great problems. I don't see this as looking at the future. I see this as
looking at a way to get benefits and raises and not really fix anything. And I'm sorry, but it makes me angry and it makes me sad. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Elaine. Any other members of the public? Seeing none, I'm going to close the public hearing. I'm going to bring it back. I'm going to ask Diana to answer a question. And Diana, we draw our water from the Feather River. Do we have adequate contracts and depth at our intake screen and pumping facilities to draw water from the Feather River north of Yuba City?
So I'll address the contracts first. So on paper, we have enough water for build out of the city. What we've found, through this drought is that our DWR contract can be curtailed severely during a drought situation. And so our other two contracts through the State Water Resources Control Board, where those are our winter water contracts, we've been able to continue to utilize those as winter water contracts. Our contract with North Yuba Water District, we've been able to 100% fully utilize. And so it's that DWR water contract that has fluctuated greatly. On average, I think we receive about 60% allocation under that contract. We just received notification last week that for this year, we're going to get a 40% allocation this year, which is much better than what we're anticipating. And so we do have sufficient water supply today. The other thing I want to note is that this year we have to update our urban water management plan, which gets approved by the state. And because of the drought, they are much more stringent on how you deal with single dry year and multi-dry year. So we'll be addressing that through our urban water management plan to show that we have sufficient water during those time frames. In terms of the depth, thankfully with the new fish screen, that lowered the intake for us drawing water from the Feather River. And so even with the river being as low as it's been, we have not had an issue with drawing water.
Okay. For public clarification also, as we've heard from the public talking about costs of employees, and this is going to come back to you as a question. In public safety within a jurisdiction, about 62 to 66% of the general fund of a city is spent on public safety, of which the majority of that is for personnel costs. There are some other costs associated with public safety, the equipment and other things. In wastewater and water, these are two separate accounts as though they were two separate businesses. And each of those must be self-sustaining on either side of that. Diana, what is the percentage that goes toward personnel, and then what goes towards the operation of the equipment, the maintenance of the equipment, just in a percentage?
I'm gonna defer to Mike Pellucci. Mike, do you know off the top of your head so the majority goes to the chemicals, the material services and supplies, electricity, and a smaller portion of it goes to the personnel.
If it was inverse, then it would be anywhere between 35 and 40% personnel. How within the water component, how many personnel does the city have on water itself?
Between water distribution and the water treatment plant, I'm going to estimate that we have about 20 employees. I don't know that off the top of my head. If we add in finance staff, it's larger than that because they are an administrative function to public works. But in terms of the employees at the water treatment plant and in the distribution system, I'd say about 20.
And then the much larger run facility for the city of Yuba City would be wastewater, and roughly how many employees?
For wastewater, I'd say it's in the range of about probably 35 employees.
So to try to answer that, then the amount being spent on benefits and salary is the smaller portion of the total operation of those two separate facilities.
Yes.
Thank you very much. Any other questions from council?
Just a little observation here. Has the state reduced its requirement of conservation down to the 29%? Is that what you're saying?
Yes.
Wouldn't that make the, if there was still to be a reduction, you say from 15 to 20, that would actually perhaps give a good cause to go down instead of 10, just down to 11, because that's just under 29% right in that point there. So I, you know, I just would consider, you know, say to consider that change in it to be, at least leave it one unit higher. I can tell you I got a report in from on the computer about my water usage, and it kind of blew me away. It was we were saying we were using 52 gallons a day. That's nothing. So that really surprised me. Also, I took the liberty while I was visiting my father in San Jose to look at his bill and how they process the rate increases and stuff. Well, it's called San Jose Water District, and they supply water for many cities and jurisdiction in that area, in the Santa Clara Valley. Because it is an independent, not run by the city as an enterprise fund, they go to the PUC and they bring them the numbers, and if the POC says it looks right to them, there is no protest vote. There is no ability really to say, no, we don't want this. This is all wrong. Basically it's PUC says you get it. We actually have the most open process, the 218 process here, that actually we have to write down everything, expose everything on the numbers. And you know, we're actually, while it's much messier, like making a cake, we actually have the opportunity to speak publicly and get input.
To the mayor.
Go ahead.
Just an observation that I know that you gave some comparisons of other agencies around our region. Unfortunately, the challenge with comparing ourselves with others is not an apples and apples situation, because it's based upon our water contracts, what we pay per acre foot of water for that contract. It has to do with what our fixed costs are at the facility to treat that water and to treat the wastewater going out as we do it. So our fixed costs may not be the same as another agency. Mm-hmm. So to compare our prices with somebody else, this is an enterprise, and what we have to look at it is our debt service that we have, the infrastructure that we have to improve, and the infrastructure that we have to pay for as we're running the whole system. So it's not that we're in the business to make a profit on this, but we are in business to make sure that we provide for the citizens good, clean drinking water, and a way to get rid of that water when we flush it down the toilet. So even though it's nice to compare ourselves to other communities and other districts, these numbers are based upon our reality and what it costs us to run this operation here in Yuba City.
Yeah, that was pretty much the point of the Sacramento Bee article, is that you can't compare apples to apples when you're looking at rates. It depends upon groundwater, surface water, the type of wastewater treatment, the population. So there's so many factors that play into it. It's very difficult to really compare agencies.
Any other questions? One of the things that I think is important to realize is as we look forward in whatever the recommendations of this body is, as we move this process forward, is what is directed today, should it change in what the state allows for water allocation and what we can deliver to customers, this body would need to come back, I believe, and adjust rates if it were to be so presentable that it could reduce rates, that during the period of time, during the 5 years moving forward, that be part of the process, that if it became feasible to be able to lower those rates, that we would do that. This is not about making a big windfall of money. We need to operate the facilities. We need to continue to provide some of the very best water in our area, and certainly to be able to discharge our waste back into the river in a way that does not affect the environment, does not affect the use of the river. And currently, I cannot tell you that the area right around Shanghai Bend is the most pleasant place to be sometimes. Our ponds that we discharge to, when it's 114 degrees outside, I would suggest to you go over and stand in that area when the air is rather stagnant. It can affect how you feel about that immediate area. That's one of the most beautiful portions of the Feather River within our community. It's a wonderful place to go and visit. And should we be able to reduce what we are just currently discharging into those ponds, certainly is a way to make that just a little bit more pleasant location. So without any other input or questions from the council, direction of the council.
I would like to see or direct staff to perhaps incorporate, as you mentioned, the reduction to 29%.
Be the 11 instead of 10?
Right. Bring that back to us anyhow, at least analyze that and see what that will look like. And perhaps in a couple of weeks or whatever time it takes to analyze that and bring it back to us. I don't think we need to make a decision this evening. But I'd like to, as we go through this process, make sure that we have enough public input, which we've had some tonight. We've had that input at the workshops. But I want to make sure that we look at all of our options before we move forward.
I'd like to see it as this body to narrow the scope of what we will be looking at and asking staff to look at. I would like to at least direct them into finalizing a rate study that they'll be able to bring back as a comprehensive rate study, whether it be in the two-year plan option, the five-year plan option one, or the five-year plan option two, with any adjustments that this body sees fit to either one of those.
Mr. Mayor? One other comment on this is that, in talking about narrowing this, I would like to see us look at the 2 5-year options. I believe looking at the 2-year option is just treading water. As you mentioned, we'll be right back here 2 years from now doing this and going through this 218 process again to deal with what we need to deal with going forward. As we recently looked at our road studies, that the longer we put these things off, the more expensive it gets. So I don't want to see us pushing this down the road. I think we need to deal with it, and the earlier we deal with it, it's actually going to cost us less in the long run. So I would like to narrow it to at least the 2 5-year proposals, and with this addition of perhaps looking at what a 11-unit baseline would look like.
Mr. Mayor? If it is possible tonight at all for the council, what happens with the final rate study? It's a very fairly comprehensive document. So if you had an inclination toward one of those 5-year options more so than the other, that would be extremely helpful for staff, just because of the time and resources. We'd want to create one document that you could, as you suggested, you could maybe make slight alterations to, but rather than having two different documents that you're making alterations to two. Thank you.
That's the direction I was trying to drive the bulldozer.
Option one.
Was to be able to get into that direction. What we can take forward at this point would be recommendation from this council in the form of a motion that we can direct staff to move forward.
I make a motion that we move forward with doing a rate evaluation for the 5-year option one, with also being able to come back and reevaluate the rates.
Is that clarification? Is that on an annual basis, Councilwoman Didball, you're saying?
Yes.
Oh, thank you very much.
I agree with that. Second. And then one comment, though. If anybody really wants to know what option two results in, Robbins Water District in the county, that'll tell you what option two would do. Sorry about the pun. It's a sinking situation. It doesn't work. So option two is just would not work. So I'll agree to second option one, coming back, and then also bring with us the data on 11 unit instead of 10.
Your motion would include the 11 instead of the 10 also?
Yes.
Okay. So we have a motion and I believe a second. Okay. We have a motion and a second for direction to staff. All those in favor? Any discussion?
Yes. Point of clarification on that. On the option two, could you explain your comment of comparing it to the Robbins situation? Because
a lot of people don't know. Well, Robbins, they literally did not do any of the planning. They did not plan any. They didn't even get enough for O&M, operations and maintenance, and then capital improvements. They didn't do that for years, and so they ended up having to go out, and as a small community, they could get grants, you know, free grants, no repayment, but we don't have that option. So their system literally failed and had to do emergency process to get it, and we're not able to do that.
And I understand that, and I guess that's where my confusion is, because
I was also for certain people in here that really know that well.
Oh, my confusion is that option two actually is a higher level of repair for the system. It's not taking the priority 2-year
rate. The 2-year rate plan, not the 5-year, the 2-year rate plan.
The 2-year rate plan.
Yes. Is a no-brainer. It's a no-go. That's what Robbins did.
That part I understand, but the difference between the 5-year plan 1 and 2, as I understand it.
That's not what I'm talking about, 5-year. We're talking about the 2-year plan. I was just making comment about the 2-year plan.
Okay, understand. I agree. And that was, like I said, was just treading water. So,
sorry, it's a misunderstanding.
Okay,
I wasn't clear enough.
Because I think that, in my opinion, I would like to see the 5-year with option 2.
Oh, you want the full.
So,
not possible.
Maybe we have a vote on both.
Well, we have a motion and a second.
Understand.
That the motion and the second, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
Aye.
You're a lone wolf.
I understand.
It's just if you would now like to move forward with another recommendation.
All right. I'd like to make the recommendation or a motion to look at option number 5-year option 2 with the 11 unit portion. Put that on the table. May fail, but I think that when we look at what we have to do with our infrastructure, and as I talked about the fact that the longer we wait to do these things, the more expensive it's going to get in the long run, that it is prudent for us to look at what is going to take care of our system long term, and that option does a better job of taking care of our infrastructure long term.
We have a motion, and dies as a result of the lack of a second.
Right. Thank you.
So direction to staff will be to move forward looking at the option one to also include some analysis looking at the 11 units versus 10. So thank you very much, and we will bring that back to council.
If you'd like it at the next meeting, Diana, would that be possible, or would you prefer the following?
We can run the model to include, because it'll adjust all of the baseline allocation. So it won't just be the 1-inch, it'll be all of the meters we'll need to adjust. And so we can run the model and have the results and try to get that into a staff report by next Wednesday. for the March 15th meeting. I will have to check with our consultant, though, to see if they have the time, because I know that they're at a conference this week. So I have to check to see if they have the time. So it may not be March 15th.
Mr. Mayor, we'll do it in the most expedient fashion possible.
Given the input from Mrs. Langley, I believe that we should probably go to meetings from now in regard to that, to allow the consultant not to be pressed into time. And certainly, I don't like to see her office lights on any later than 11:30 at night. Thank you very much,
Diana. Thank you.